David, if you, I'm not going to be eating these while we're talking, and these have been untouched by human hands. So if you weaken, just come up and take one. Everybody will think, oh, that's awesome, and I know you're coming.
May I ask you to present and be the speaker?
Huh?
May I ask you to present and speak? Because my voice is again like a bit.
Oh, okay, okay.
It would be really powerful today.
Cool.
Yeah.
What were we going to say?
Sorry, I have no idea. We make the slides, they look at it, and then they should fire back.
Yeah. Cool.
Minutetaker, JavaScript, sure. Everybody who's wearing a hat is the Minutetaker. Thank you. Start writing.
Martin and I did agree that we would pick scribes from the people who are wearing hats. So thank you guys for being here. We figure you could wear a couple of hats during a working group meeting. Well, we're just adding another one.
Everybody was wearing a hat, wasn't it? Stuart is not listening.
Yeah, don't make us watch it on MeetEcho.
It was a good backup, so
it's a nice speaker.
You're going to ask.
Well, since the area directors at this point can't think at all, you're way one.
So welcome to the. Is it already starting? Well, let's see, how late is it? Yeah, two minutes over. So hello, welcome to the. Is that high? Transport area session on Friday, which is the second one. And I'm surprised to see some people at all, so thank you for being here. We have one minute taker, but he claims that he needs a backup minute taker.
Actually, the one minute taker begged for backup, which is, I just want to put the right tone on that.
Sorry, who's there? Oh, thank you, Allison. And then we need a Jabber scribe just to see if there's anybody in Jabber. All right, thank you, Aaron. So. And Spencer's bringing up the slides, and then I shut up for the time being.
And actually, we need to do your laptop anyway.
My laptop?
Yeah.
Ah, I know why. Okay.
Oh, and are you presenting off the Google things? Because I did make one change.
I'm going to make the change. So. Wait.
So you think I'm standing in the box to present?
Or sitting at the mic here.
So. Oh, that works too?
Yeah, that works too.
Okay, cool. So what are we doing? Okay, so we have achieved our goal of spending 5 minutes on administrivia. How are we doing on time? Yeah, at least. So, hi, I'm Spencer Dawkins.
This is Dr. Morton to my right. Welcome to the Transport Area second session, where we are apparently starting Friday afternoon on 10 minutes before noon. Good job, because this is a slow start. Two things we wanted to talk about with you all today were feedback from, our take from the SPUD buff, because it seems like it's turning into sort of a big deal for the transport area. And the other one is to just talk about the area reorganization, specifically in transport context. And this is something we've been talking about with people for a while, and it's something we've been talking about with the transport chairs on Sunday, and we talked about in the first session, which was on Tuesday, yeah. So like I said, just wanted to kind of walk through that with the community and kind of see where people are. SPUD was a non-working group forming buff, so we met that objective. We did not form a working group. We had about 200 people in the room, and it seemed like most of them were not reading email. I wanted to be sure and mention this is the outcome of the IAB semi workshop on stack evolution in the middle box internet, which is what semi stands for, and that this is related to the IAB stack evolution program, which I actually got added to Wednesday, something. There was a lot of interest from the community in this, and I wanted to say that this was, I think, a pretty broad community. I was spending time this week thinking about, you know, who cares and who doesn't care at the IETF about the things that we were talking about at the SPUD buff, and I had kind of punted on routing and int, and then somebody grabbed me in the hall and talked to me about looking at this in a data center context, the problems they would have been solving with it would have been the problems that people care about who care also care about things like Trill. So it seems like there's more people here that should care than don't, or that shouldn't. And so we're still trying to understand. Like I say, we're still trying to understand what we're looking at. We have a lot of other X over UDP kinds of things going on, so we're going to need to do some coordination there. SPUD and Joe Hildebrand is actually pretty clear about this, that, you know, kind of where they are is doing prototyping to see what makes sense at this point. This is another reason why it wasn't a working group buff. A couple of topics we spent a lot of time on at the semi-workshop, and we did not spend loads of time on at the SPUD buff, but just, like I said, just to kind of keep all this stuff in context. One was application to path signaling, and one was path to application signaling. And so we've got, you know, some kind of architectural impacts as a result of SPUD in general, and certainly as a result of the A to P and P to A topics that, like I say, hang on. We'll be surprised if we don't lose more, if we don't learn more. I've mentioned this at the end of the BOF itself, but I don't think this is going just one direction, and this is me just giving my impressions, which are not always right. But I think that we may end up with stuff in the IRTF. We may end up with stuff in a couple of working groups. We may end up with stuff that needs to float around for a while before we figure out what to do with it. And none of those things would surprise me, and I think that's, you know, like I say, I think that's good. My model for stuff like that was probably the peer-to-peer infrastructure IAB workshop a bunch of years ago that we got eventually three working groups out of. So like I said, I don't think that the SPUD BOP turns into a SPUD working group with no other processing required. So please pay attention. Am I saying this right, that the implementation work is happening on GitHub also? So they say, come one, come all. I see Brother Trammell headed to the... I really want you to do this in a Texas drawl, too, but...
I was born in Tennessee, so I think I'd get shot from multiple directions.
No, the people from Tennessee who got shot in Texas were at the Alamo.
Yes,
you're safe.
Volunteers. Go Vols. Wow, it's been 20 years since I said that. All right, so the prototype for now, and we do stress prototype, so there's the slides from SPUD. It's under a BSD license, I believe. It's sort of a let many transports bloom on top of this sort of thing. We're looking first to get sort of, if you remember the TSV area presentation from the last TSV area meeting, there was this thing called Transport Prime, which is the thing that sits on top of SPUD. So the next that we have just the setting up tubes and tearing down tubes and doing just the basic state management. I don't think there's anything in there that uses any of the marking stuff yet. And we don't have a transport on top of it yet, right? I mean, the only transport is it gives you a service that looks like UDP. Here's a datagram. So the next step in experimentation is actually getting any sort of existing user-space transport stacks up on top of this. So grab a look at the SPUD slides. Talk to Joe. Talk to me. Talk on the SPUD list actually is the right thing to do. We're trying to spin up some running code on this pretty quickly.
Cool. Thank you. Did anybody else have anything that they needed to say to the broader community about the BOF? Or Brother Mathis.
I actually had a question.
Who are you?
Matt Mathis.
Okay, thank you.
It's recently come to my attention, and apparently a lot of other people have had this thought over the last year, at how a profound assumption it was in the early days of the design of their protocols that TCP preserves idempotents. And if anybody is aware of in any context, a conversation about imagining what would happen if we tried to change that. Because if you don't have to assume idempotents, or if you assume that you have idempotents, I guess is the right way to say it, then you can always do racy connects. You can do multiple connects on multiple radios, on multiple devices, multiple paths, and you don't care if more than one of them was successful. And that would make a whole lot of this negotiation stuff just go away. I mean, the ossification question almost becomes I won't say a no-brainer, but there's becomes a migration strategy to do all sorts of things. And this assumption seems to be very deeply built in, but it was never explicit. And it was explicit in the design of things like TCP Fast Open and in various places in the past. But I don't know if it was ever been considered as a fact that it wasn't a necessary assumption from the beginning. Mm. So I'm getting blank stares. Is anybody else aware of any work in this space? Not as phrase. It sounds like an opportunity for some good heresy. So the technical language is something is idempotent if you don't care about replay. So it's actually, it preserves... So at the connect level. So for instance, if you do TFO, so TCP does it because you can't accidentally do a three-way handshake with more than one version of the server at the same time. If I'm just saying, imagine a service which is you hand it a host name and some arguments, and it returns a file descriptor, which is a chunk of data in a cache. This is the network as defined by the browser people. Okay? If the network as defined by the browser people was allowed to use any method necessary, it could open lots of connections, it could use different protocols, it could do all sorts of things, which it can't do now because it doesn't want to, it can't assume that that transaction doesn't have side effects. And so it can't run the transaction twice. And so it forces you to serialize testing different methods. But most of the web doesn't care. Get is almost always actually idempotent, and so it doesn't care. I can replay it. Put is not. But the issue is, if this one bit was exposed up the stack, if it was understood that the applications had to control this one bit from above, then in fact it becomes possible to do a whole lot of optimizations that we don't do today, that are sort of off the table today.
Kevin Fall, Carnegie Mellon. This is related to two people ago, but I have a question related to that one too. The first one is, with this work that's in this stage, we also have at the same time the DTN working group that's now been formed, which is going to be doing 50-50 evolution. And this is just a general thought, I guess. Should that group, or maybe the DTNRG that still exists, work on top of or with this set of stuff that's evolving? Would that be a sensible thing? I'm seeing some nodding. Yes. I see one nod anyway. At least I see the hat going up and down. What's that? Okay. But I guess then the question is, if people are interested in discussing that, I and maybe others of the working group would be. I don't know if this relates to, this is different than quite your question, but a thing I've run into recently is a case in which there's HTTP GET and the stuff at the server has out of order data because the page content has been decoded through a forward error correcting code. So you have stuff that's present in a cache beyond the sequence of the stuff that's immediately available for the request. And trying to figure out how to do that and make it work in HTTP's world is, there are certainly ways, but it's the thing that is not apparently there conceptually. So I think it might relate because after you do one get, you get you change what it is you're looking for.
Yeah, so Matt mentioned opportunities for heresy. And I think if nobody gets burned at the stake in the next year in transport, we're not doing our jobs. This may have implications for NOMCOM.
I'm sorry, I missed a bit of the beginning, but I have a couple of thoughts on the spud box, Chana Iyengar. So just something to Matt's comment earlier, a correction is that gets aren't, you can't reasonably consider all gets as idempotent, even though that's what the spec says, for what it's worth. I think that one of the things I wanted to point out here, when we're talking about a prototype, it is, there's the SPUD prototype. In addition, there's also the DTLS draft that Christian presented. I want to draw attention to that draft as well, because SPUD isn't one thing at this point in time. That is a prototype, and as Joe himself said at the mic, he said he hopes this is not, or he doesn't expect this to become the protocol. It's important to separate the problem statement, the requirements section, from the particular prototype, and I think the DTLS draft does some of that by just offering up another alternative shim that is actually different from, if you see, how SPUD is even designed or how it's even built. And I just wanted to bring attention to that.
And thank you. And I think that is a good way of pointing out to the room that we're still at the but what about this level of precision for what we're talking about.
So thank you, Jonna, for mentioning that, because I'd totally forgotten it. I'm like about that far through a coffee that I need to be that far through for this conversation. I did want to say that sort of this entire idempotence conversation, I'd like to see it started on the SPUD list, because I think it has implications for what you can do with those transports on top of this layer. I don't think I want to take the entire TSV area meeting for this. I mean, I'd love to, actually. This is a lot of fun. But
I think it actually belongs in TAPS, because it's what makes TAPS feasible.
You can have multiple two addresses ever since 822, I think. You can have multiple two addresses in an email.
Jana Inga, this conversation is already happening. This conversation is happening in the TLS working group. Okay. It's happening right now in the TLS working group with TLS 1.3, where they're talking about zero RTT connects, which they have to assume that the content is replayable, exactly like with TCP Fast Open we had to.
I am so glad that we have these conversations.
All right, so everybody who cares about transport now has to go into the TLS working group, or at least the future of it.
Everybody who's interested in transport should have been going to the TLS working group 10 years ago.
Touché.
I love my life. This is great. We can tell Stephen and Kathleen that they may actually already be transport area directors. Problem solved. Anything else we need to say about SPUD? Okay, let's move to the second part of our time together. And like I say, I think we're kind of moving into the what are we going to do when we grow up kind of conversation here. I'm presenting a couple of things here that were from Yari's slides from plenary, and I'll go through them quickly, but just to make sure that, you know, because some people don't go to the plenary, and some people have slept since then, and some people haven't slept since then. But just, you know, what Yari was talking about with the general ISG restructuring topic was matching the IETF structure to the current topics that we're working on, making sure that we're supporting growth in emerging topic areas, which when I was talking to the 2013 NOMCOM, I thought transport was still going to be a nice, quiet place to be an area director, and I could not have been more wrong. So the emerging topic area certainly covers us. Also includes some various open source efforts broadly throughout the IETF, including us. Matching management resources to the workload and providing better flexibility for the ISG and for the IETF as a whole. The things that we have done on the ISG, doing some flexible assigning to from area directors to working group, and this was as much a tools thing as anything else. If you look at the working group page on the IETF website and scan down to the ops and management area, you will see that some of the working groups there have responsible area directors that is not either one of the ops ADs. So that's what we're talking about there. And that was put in place for ops, but you know, now that the tool is supported, we have opportunities to do that anywhere in the IETF. Doing a lot more focus on data models work and wrapped around the routing area. And another thing that's driving this, as we said, Benoit has given up a number of his working groups so that he could focus more on the Yang coordinator type functions for the IETF and for the ISG. You've seen the area reorganization that is in flight for apps and RAI, that we're talking about combining those, moving through from four ADs to three, and this would be combined into an area called Applications in Real Time, or ART. We talk about the, you know, various working groups moving between area directors and areas. That happens on an ongoing basis within the IETF. We may be doing a little bit more of that now than we usually do, just because we're moving other things around. But you know, that's something that the ISG talks about pretty much every year at the retreat in May anyway. So, Matt?
It seems to me that if the responsible area director doesn't need to be a member of the area in which the group is chartered in, the area in which the group is chartered in seems sort of irrelevant.
So the thing that we're thinking there was that there are some working groups that have affinities with other working groups, so that the working group gets to stay with the other working groups that they're closely with.
Because each area is scheduled as a flat thing.
Yeah, that is scheduling being an excellent a side effect of that.
Scheduling bucket is one use of the grouping.
Yeah.
And that's orthogonal to responsible AD.
Right.
That's good. Okay, makes sense.
And we're hoping to do a better job of scheduling. That's actually on the list of topics for the ISG retreat that's coming up.
Brian Haberman speaking as an area director.
That's what you are.
Stop reminding me. I wanted to expand a little bit on the area director being outside the area, but the work group being in a particular area. So there's also the affinity between the work groups within the area, and that was one of the big concerns that we discussed when we first started talking about this. We wanted to make sure we didn't lose that relationship. And what we found was that a fair number of area directors aren't necessarily pigeonholed into one area either, so it made it fairly flexible way to do it.
Yeah.
David Black, the other thing that this mechanism works very nicely for, and in fact, the latest working group that the ISG just did this with is a good example, is sometimes you find area groups that land pretty darn close to the boundary. And the latest example they did it for is UTA, which is in the apps area, but it's a security group, and so it now has Stephen Farrell as an out-of-area area director, and that's a very nice way to deal with a work group that spans area boundaries.
Right, and we... Speaking as a surviving, as a survivor of 3 years on the IAB, we see, I think we are continuing to see more proposals for new work in the ITF that if they don't span areas, they're right on the border. And the poster child within transport this week is probably TCP Inc. If you can't make a compelling case for that being in either transport or security, you're just not paying attention. So, like I said, that's kind of flexibility. We're into that. So, and just being able to for the ISG to be able to support the work that the IETF community needs to do. Let's see what do we do next. I should call your attention to things that appear on the next couple of slides in bold because they seem especially pregnant with meaning to the transport area, to Martin and myself. Looking at the reduction of ISG tasks and workload and further reorganization in the TSV area with the goal of forming the AD's role to a role that fits well the potential candidate pools. I have this phrase that I've been using more recently, but I've been thinking about for a while, making sure that the transport area gets the management that the transport area deserves. I would like for that to be a good thing. And as we, as we are developing ideas on the ISG, bringing them to the community, and this is, remember, is probably much for the ISG as it is for the IETF. The ISG organization is just an organization. The important things are in the IETF are what you all do as participants. So what we think we're talking about here is, like I say, that TSV gets the leadership that you deserve. Martin and I plan to ask for a third transport area director in this NOMCOM cycle, aiming at reducing, keeping the 50% time commitment. What we've, well, can keep going. We're also introducing a TSV triage function, basically having people that are not the area directors looking at drafts that are going into ITF last call, making sure that drafts that need special attention from the transport area get that attention. Offloading at least some of their views to the transport directorate, and being the contact point for other areas if they need early review of drafts. We are very interested in suggestions from the community, both for how we organize the work and how we recruit management for the work. Wanted to be sure make sure you guys know that. I should stop for a second here and let anybody who needs to run for the microphones run for the microphones. I do not hear. Oh, okay, go.
So something that came up a couple of AD cycles ago and got shot down by actually IESG processes is I had proposed splitting an AD ship with Nandita.
I'm sorry?
Splitting an AD ship with Nandita at Google. And there are some process technical problems, like only allowed to cast one vote as two people. But it, in fact, we had very complementary skills, and it would probably have been a very, very effective relationship. But it wasn't permitted at the time, and now we've both gone on to other things, and so it's not likely that either of us would do something like that. But one of the things, I hate to draw this analogy, but congressional staffers have a lot of authority of doing many, many things that congressmen have authority to do except casting ballots. And that thought process it appears that the triage is actually sort of part of that. A formal way within the process of deputizing assistant ADs, in fact, even creation of the title of assistant AD, that can do some of the things that the AD is responsible for, but not certain key things.
I detect another serving area director coming up behind you at the mic.
You guys should stop inviting me to these meetings. So actually, Matt, the interesting thing here is that we have some very very preliminary thoughts coming out of a couple of different area directors who want to do just that. If you want to go to the extreme, Stephen Farrell thinks that we should be at 7 area directors. And what that requires is being able to push a lot of stuff back out into the community. We just haven't had a chance to really formalize what that might look like or what kinds of things would get pushed out. But I think what we mentioned at the admin plenary on Wednesday is that there are a couple of different area directors that are going to start doing some experiments within their area to see how that could be done.
Right. I always try to do the commercial for RFC 3933, which allows us to do process experiments where we can make changes to things that are covered by our process BCPs, but do that as an experiment. And if that turns out to be a bad idea, the experiment ends and the BCP goes back to being what the BCP was before. So we don't have to have consensus to change it back. That I think that gives us more flexibility than we had during a lot of the discussions about ITF process in the early 2000s. And I think the other thing that goes along with that is, as we're talking about thinking about things as experiments, some of you guys know this and some of you don't, but I was a survivor of the process conflagration of the early 2000s. And one of the things there, the two things that happened there from my perspective were that we felt like we had to come up with answers that worked for everybody before we could try anything, because at that time you had to change the process BCP that covered everybody. So we spent a lot of time arguing about, well, that won't work in my area, and things like that. And then the other thing was, you know, we had to get it right because we were changing the process BCP, and changing it back would be even worse.
So
between those two things, I think we've made progress at making both of them less of a bottleneck than they were the last time we spent time trying to make the ITF work better.
So sort of stepping down a level, there actually needs to be a title, TSV area directorship isn't good enough to convince my employer to spend extra money on it. But on the other hand, an assistant AD, which is a title with a job description and some sort of vetting process, is easier to justify as saying, okay, I want to commit a hunk of time to this on an ongoing basis as a job. And so it's not just allowing more than one person to sit in the seat, but actually creating defined assistant roles that have real specifications and process associated with them, even if they're experimental. I mean, that's independent of the experimental attribute.
Yeah, maybe I can add a bit, but my voice is still working. I think that's on the long run, it's the right thing, and we should consider this how we make it working. And I just wanted to add that we have the triage team, which is like the thing we're trying out right now in order to see where we can go in the future and define such a role in maybe an experimental way or a BCB later on.
So like I said, this is a conversation. I probably should not be responding to everything that somebody says, but we had this moment of silence during the admin plenary on Wednesday night where we said, you know, we've been talking about ways to try to make the area director role less busy, but of course the area directors were the ones that were working on it, and we didn't have time to do that because we're all busy. Not all of us have a highly developed appreciation for irony, but I think I do. So after appreciating that irony for a bit, I really want to emphasize, especially in this part of the community, how reliant we are going to be on suggestions that you guys make. And, you know, one of the reasons we're taking minutes at this session is so we don't forget the things that people like Matt are suggesting. Because I think, you know, transport is maybe not the area that is at the leading edge of what we need to do here, but we're one of a couple of areas that need to get this right the most and need to get this right the soonest.
So, Spencer, keying off what you said about running experiments, so we don't have that won't work in my area, would like to suggest, I think this is something you've mentioned before, which strikes me as a good idea, that as you put the description together for the third transport AD, assuming that goes forward, the NOMCOM is going to be selecting two of them this cycle. I suggest putting some words in there to suggest to the NOMCOM that maybe the three ADs aren't peers, that the job divides up by areas of responsibility not in equal fashion. So maybe one AD is focused more on running working groups and others focused more on reviews. That's likely to help more here because we have such difficulty with time commitment. Whereas I look at the other three AD areas, it's just, oh my goodness, look at the number of working groups and things that have to be done. The three ADs wind up being two ADs and add a peer.
Okay, so I said I wasn't going to reply to every comment that was made, but that's an interesting comment. So a word that you may have heard in the hallway but probably have not seen written down in any meaningful place is smallerizing the ISG. And this is a Stephen Farrell phrase, trademark that is apparently under application at this point, that we were using to describe the what if we had a seven-member ISG. The ISG as a group, as repeating, has not had the chance to talk about this because we're all really busy. But after Stephen said that, while we were not talking, some of us were thinking, and I was thinking that one of the ways you might want to do that is that you get down to the idea of a area, an area director responsibility, and how you staff that responsibility, being not necessarily, you know, one person doing everything. If you go with the model that we, you know, had the RFC editor, and there's an awful lot of stuff that still talks about the RFC editor, but that's not just one person. It actually hasn't been one person for a very long time, but it's the RFC editor responsibility. And it's gotten divided up into like the production center and the independent stream editor and all kinds of stuff. But that started out being one guy, just like area directors, just for a moment, or archaeology. All the areas used to have one area director, all of them. So, you know, we've been moving away from the one area director per area model for a while, and maybe we're ready to take the next step on that. And like I say, no promises, because someday the ISG is going to have time to think about this and talk, and other area directors may think about things and talk about things. But that's one of the things that I'm thinking about right now.
Maybe I can also add a bit, like, one of the ideas to have like two ADs being nominated in that cycle was to say, maybe you have one of those who are nominated is like one of the standing ADs, probably, who is like experienced and can take the day job, but also to allow the people who are new to the job to ramp up slowly. Maybe they don't have a 50% time commitment at the beginning, but maybe they start with like 10, 20% and but tie over, they grow while the old one sneaks out, I don't know. But it's like balancing depending on workload, demand, and so on.
Aaron Falk, I have spent a lot of time over the years helping to beat the bushes for qualified transport area director candidates. And I believe that transport is different from other areas because if you're an equipment vendor, it's easy to make the case that the internet area or the routing area functioning well is in a financial interest that it's good to have to take somebody and not let them work for the company but go off and do something for the community for a couple years. And apps area, same thing. Rye, lots of new businesses. But there aren't that many companies that make a lot of money off of transport. So we're left largely with very large companies who, through their largesse and desire to be good network citizens, can make people available. That wasn't always the case in the transport area. For a long time, the area directors in the transport area came from academia. As research goes, interest in transport goes up and down, and the timeline to get new technologies through the ITF has increased. The research community has, at least in the U.S., has grown a little bit away. Europe has been much more energized about research in the transport area, but you still don't see a whole lot of people who are funded to do things like be an area director. So I've had a long rant, and I apologize to those people who've heard this before, but I'll keep this recitation of it brief, which is I think that there has been so much benefit to the the world community from a well-functioning internet that there should be, and that's in everybody's interest to see that continue, that there should be some funding available to have qualified candidates get support if money is the issue that is preventing them from acting as an area director, that they should be able to do this. And I've been going around saying that ISOC should do this and ICANN should do this. Somebody should do this because a lot of companies are making a lot of money and we need to have good people in this position. And there are people, particularly in academia, who would be well qualified to do this, but don't have the flexibility that you do in a large company to go off and take a couple years off and contribute their time to the ITF. It doesn't help you get tenure. In fact, it's as somebody who's trying to get tenure probably couldn't do it. So I'm very pleased that after whining about this for many years, it looks like there's been some movement on the topic. And I believe that if there is somebody where some amount, and I have no idea how much, but I would guess that it's not very much, money would make a difference between standing for an area director position or not, I think that money can be made available by way of ISOC. And I don't know the details, but I think it's the kind of thing that somebody who's interested could stand for NOMCOM and could make that clear. Unfortunately, many of the candidates from the academic community have kind of wandered away. And so I think there's a little bit of an outreach task to let people know that this is a possibility. And I think that there might be people who would be excited about doing this. And so that's going to require, I think, a little bit of work, especially by people who might be in this room who are more plugged in the research community. I'm not very plugged in right now. So I'm just sort of bringing that up. I think it would be a very good thing if we had folks who are up to date on the research literature looking at some of the new stuff that's coming into the transport area. Thank you.
So maybe I can reply. Luckily, half of the 80 sitting here are coming from academia. Yeah, but also I get a bit of time funding from academia working on this. But travel is something else. Alison Mankin also had the idea of having like a fund where companies chip in money so that it could support, for instance, people who are from academia or other people who are capable of being an AD, but they say, I don't have the funding for doing it. So, yeah. Maybe it's ISOC, maybe it's somebody else. So maybe you should pursue the idea. Yeah.
Does that exist? Because there was a request at some point by somebody for support, meaning money. It actually got lost in translation, but there was a request for funding that came to us, Google, and I handed it around, and it took two laps because a whole bunch of people didn't understand that support meant money.
It's quite unusual.
No, support could mean sending people.
Yeah.
And they said, no, we've got a whole lot of business before the IETF. We don't want to appear to be coloring the process.
Okay, so you mean in that case it would be better if there's a fund where the chip
and
the
right.
money.
There has to right. be an hourglass that separates the there has to be a certain amount of distance between the funders and the fundees.
Okay, cool. Good idea.
It was also a consideration there.
I would also point out that there's a very strong expectation that people in AD positions serve the IETF first and their employer second, which is rather different than the employer writing a check directly.
Yes, Mirja, go for it.
Mia Kulevin, I think money is less the problem. The other one is actually time commitment, because if you're on research, you can't spend 100% time on being TSV ID, because then if you don't do research for 2 years, you can't do research afterwards anymore. So that's what you propose is a really important step to get the chance for academics to actually fill this position. And the other point I wanted to raise is something completely different, and I don't want to start the discussion now, and I think the discussion has been there already, but I just want to mention it for the minutes, basically. The other way to reduce the workload is actually to reduce the number of documents.
Just the number. I want to reply, but I don't.
Michael Scharf, on that comment, the other way to remove the workload is to stop working on academic topics and shut down a couple of working groups. And we have some examples that are candidates for this.
So we had much actually much a little bit of amusement on Wednesday night because about 10 minutes before the ISG took the stage, we found out that Pete Resnick was going to close a working group during the dot exchange as he stepped down as area director for apps, and I was like, maybe we should all close one down.
We're trying hard, so. But sometimes not that easy. So.
So here we are.
This is banned. It's gone back. Hello?
Cool. Just let me keep an eye on time. I'm sorry. Cool. Yeah. We're 120 or something. Yeah. So I think we're good. Still out of time. So I wanted to put something in front of you all for you to be considering it. Yes.
Well, you can see.
Oh, you're not over there yet. Yeah. Yeah. Good. Been invented and stuff. We're waiting for the. It could be okay. Yeah. We're getting there.
It's part of the idea.
There you go. yes, welcome.
For the next slide.
Yeah, well.
It's wide on wide.
Yes. So what we're showing you now is what we Martin and I told the NomCom last year that resulted in Martin being returned. And to be sure, level set this, what we're talking about here is the ISG sends position descriptions to the NomCom. The NomCom is empowered to listen to the community and say, the ISG may think that that's what needs to happen, but what needs to happen is something else over here. But this is the starting point for the NomCom each year. And this was discussed in a lot of detail back in the Orlando IETF in 2013. And Martin and I have reviewed it the last 2 years when I was wrong. I was renewed this year.
Right.
Yeah.
It was not already, but
yeah.
I said, yes, you're right.
Yeah. Okay. See, Friday afternoon. And we are achieving Friday afternoon at this point, I think. So the other thing I want to say as we go into this, Martin will be finishing his second term, 2 year term, as area director this coming year that NomCom is doing the evaluation for. I will be finishing my second term the following year. Okay, so to level set that. And also to say if Spencer and Martin really are going to say that we need 3 area directors, there's only 2 of us sitting up here now. So it seems like that would create an opening. This is what we send people to. This year, the ITEST now begins. This is the description here. And on the following page, so you'll want to review this in detail at your leisure. But this is pretty much what's going to go to NomCom, more or less. I believe what Martin and I are going to suggest is that instead of a 25 to 40 hour commitment, that what we're talking about here is a 15 to 25 hour commitment from each area director. And I believe that's, in the absence of input from you guys, And you don't have to answer now, but we need to know by roughly June. But in the answer of input for you guys, what we would be telling them is what we've told them in the past, with nothing changing except the time commitment. Mr. Black.
David Black. Plus one on the time change, as I think you've recognized for a long time, Spencer, actually both of you, 50% is a magic number. And being able to say it could be less than half time makes a big difference. The other thing I would suggest, and I don't want to do it, having already done open text surgery on the screen once this week, I don't care to do it again, is it looks like the out-of-area AD concept is working. And I would scrub this advice to identify areas of expertise that transport needs, but that might be reasonable to come via an out-of-area AD. Because I think in the past, the guidance has always assumed that all of the expertise that transport needs that transport ADs provide, and I think the out-of-area AD concept probably establishes that there are some things that perhaps the NOMCOM could say, oh, that's covered because so-and-so is over there and, by the way, knows this chunk of transport really well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Other comments? This is good. Someone is taking the eye test.
No. We should be able to do that.
You too.
Yeah, we have to have them. Yeah, it's like you got us.
Okay, reading in details, please add route into areas of interaction. UDP and CAP is going to be a major adventure with them. Sorry.
Allison Mankin, pausing to in my note-taking. For attracting an academic, it was struck by the fact that you weren't actually on the program in IAB till just now, Spencer. An academic would probably greatly value the idea that they kind of automatically get into IAB and they have a role in architecture. That's sort of a distinguishing characteristic of, I think, transport academics' interests. So that could possibly make it more attractive for a professor that they kind of get into a community. They're not just doing, you know, routinely processing a bunch of specs, because there's probably a perception that it's not as interesting in a research sense as it really actually is. So you might also sell it a little more, and this may be more of an outreach thing, but the people who apply are going to read this and they're going to say, no, this isn't actually what I thought transport's about.
Thank you for that observation. Just a couple things. From my perspective, transport is way more entertaining now than it was even when I became area director 2 years ago. See the Spuds BOF and the Stack Evolution program at IB and everything like that that's going on with that. The thing about me just joining the Stack Evolution program, Martin has been a member of that program since the beginning, and I didn't want to pile both their directors in at once at the beginning of the program. Now it's looking like I would be the area director for work that was coming in. I was the responsible area director for sponsoring SPUD this time. Me asking to be added now made a lot more sense to me, and I think that took a whole day for the IAB to approve.
So one of the things that I have worried about in this job description, I mean, it's the same description that's been around for a while, basically. One of the things that's maybe a hallmark of transport more than other areas in the IETF is there's a lot of, for lack of a better word, I'll say dogma here about things like congestion control. And it's important and I don't know how to put it in the job description, that people are both aware of and support the dogma, but are also skeptical of it. And there's a very subtle balance there that's actually important for the evolution of transport. And you don't want somebody who is just going to say, oh, we're going to reinvent the entire internet differently, and you don't want somebody who believes that the gods of TCP got it right and we mustn't change anything. Drawing the line between that has to have a sense of, I want to say history, but that's maybe not the right word, about why things are the way they are, and the skepticism of it.
That's a good point. The point will be how we figure this out in the job description.
Yeah, I don't know how to say it in a job description.
And maybe even more important would be that people out of the transport community are volunteering for the NOMCOM, to be in the NOMCOM, to emphasize that fact. Because I had the feeling that in the past there were, on the last rounds, there was a limited number or zero people from transport in the NOMCOM. And if transport believes we should have impact there, then somebody should volunteer. If they make it on NOMCOM, it's a different question.
Bob Briscoe, that was an extremely profound thought, and that's very important. I've got a much more mundane thing to say, I'm afraid. But what Matt said was very important. The much more mundane thing is that I think we're moving into a new phase where we've seen pressure for faster acceleration, the possibility of more open loop control, and so we have nothing on here really about the interaction between traffic and the network, and so the AQM area and buffers, and also like David said, the routing area is interested in what's going on in AQM, not just layering and so on.
And if I could do just an area director interrupt for a moment, these slides have now been uploaded.
Jenna Enger, I think I agree very much with what Matt said, but I want to also point out that congestion control appears 4 or 5 times in that paragraph, which seems to suggest that everything the ADs do is congestion control. And what I'm missing in that paragraph is interactions with, just as Bob mentioned, things that are traffic and network. I'm also missing things that are transport and security. I'm also not seeing things that are transport and applications. Finally, the people who actually use us. This has always been a gripe of mine, that we seem to completely miss the ball on what applications actually want and how we ought to interact with them. Because ultimately, applications drive transport use. And while congestion control is a really important problem and it's important to get it right, and we've gotten it wrong 50 million times and we continue to keep getting it wrong, there are many other pressing issues of protocol design and architecture that will be that will require the AD's insights, and these will come from cross area imagination. So I'd love to see some more sort of cross area experience or thought in that paragraph, and some little less congestion control.
Thank you.
I think that's an extremely important point. I'm going to crash us into another thing because I remembered something from NOMCOM. It's really hard for an AD to get the job without having been a working group chair. And yet some of the people who would be great at this job could do the AD job without having been a working group chair. That's a really different kind of role at the IETF. So maybe you ought to design the third AD-ship as one that doesn't have to have very much process experience, but has to have that imagination, et cetera, and be explicit about that to the NOMCOM, because we make the assumption that you want a lot of IETF experience of that nature, and if you change that, it'll actually help the candidacy a lot.
Allison, if I could presume to call upon your Nam-Kam Fu for a moment. One of the things that Martin and I had been talking about is the way that I perceive Nam-Kam's pick IABs, which is basically, you know, the IAB has five chartered responsibilities, and it's not that everybody needs to understand all five chartered responsibilities. I was on there for 3 years, and I don't think I ever understood IANA. But that the combination of the people being reviewed and the people not being reviewed be able to fulfill all the chartered responsibilities. Martin and I have been talking about, well, maybe that's something we need to be talking about with Nam-Kam, is to say, you know, not that we need three people who know how to do working group management, you know, just name one, but that the function of the area directorship for transport has to be able to do that. And so that would require them to have at least a brief conversation with the not being reviewed area director to make sure that they know which boxes have already been at least partially checked, and which ones they need, you know, they need to be looking for in other one or more other area directors. Does that sound like something we could ask a Nam-Kam to do?
Well, so I mean, I've forgotten, but I'm pretty sure the magic word is slate, and you review a slate for the IAB. The reason that I know it's the word, but I can't remember if slate actually appears in BCP 10 or not. But you review a slate, and the slate includes considering how it compares, it relates to the sitting people. So if you were to say, and we request that you treat this group, this area, as a slate, not as, you know, individuals who are completely uninteroperable and not standing, I think that would be very clear, and it's probably a good idea for the art people to do as well. So you could almost say, where there are three, and probably even where there's two, could you take a slate-like view, not a one-by-one, knock-em-off kind of approach to things? And that would be, I think, very, very good guidance. And, of course, the Nam-Kam's allowed to say, forget it. But but they have to do that on the basis of community objections, not just, you know, arbitrarily. And I think it would be very good communication.
Thank you.
I'm taller than Allison. Gary Fairstein, you're losing my voice. If you wanted to try and make yourself a bit more visible to the rest of the world as to what the transport's doing, one of the things that Michael reminds me started in the IRTF is trying to describe what research challenges lie in each of the areas where we have working groups. What really are the longer distance things that we're interested in doing or may be interested in doing? I mean, that's not the same as the job description, but if you're trying to paint a picture of how exciting the transport area is, you have to remove all the nuts and bolts on the congestion control, and the meltdown protection and how you pick path MTU, because we've got to do all this stuff. But that's kind of just got to be done. But there is actually good stuff that's on the horizon. If we're thinking about somebody taking this job for several years, there's things that might happen. I mean, I just wonder if it's worth kind of worth resurrecting the idea of creating a web page where maybe working group chairs initially dump in where they see interesting things happening in their working groups. Maybe other people can contribute, and we can kind of get some grand challenges for transport. I mean, it sounds like it's IAB stuff, but I mean, if we're trying to get area directors who think ahead, then it might be useful.
Thank you.
So I think the discussion we've had in like the last 10 minutes has been one of the most insightful discussions about leadership in the transport area that I've ever heard in a public forum. And I'm really sad that Allison, who made several great points, but is also taking minutes, was in the line, and I'm worried that some of these great points are not on there. Are you taking notes? Awesome. I feel much better now. Along those lines, I think it would I would encourage you to review the input that you collected today on like the transport directorate mailing list or some mailing list where people can have a chance to contribute to it, because I think this is all really good stuff. Another point I want to make, I guess the discussion of, I think it was, maybe it was Matt's point about getting the balance between having an architecture and extending the architecture. One of the things I got out of, I was fortunate enough to be part of this project called New Arch several years ago, where there was a lot of talk about changing the internet architecture. And it seems to me that there's a job description which is, you know, transport area directors should understand the principles of the internet architecture, why we have the architecture that we have, and also have the judgment and be able to seek counsel on when those rules don't apply anymore. I don't think we can. I don't think we can put the burden of having, and the position doesn't require, you know, this is a person who actually holds the keys to changes in the internet architecture. But they need to understand what the issues are, and they need to be able to. They need to know people they can ask about the implications of things when they come up, because, you know, as work managers, as the gates to work going in, going out of the ITF, that's the big important responsibility of having this position. And so, you know, getting good advice is really important.
I believe, but I would have to double check the current job description, that the biggest change from after Orlando in the job description was that I remember right that we added sentence saying that the ADs need not to know all the technical details, but they need to be able to consult experts, so that this step should be implemented there. I'm not sure about the architecture part. That for sure, it's
okay. So maybe it's in there. And then another point, and this is really sort of out of scope of what this group can do, but I have this long-standing objection that we select our non-com by a random draw from the community. I think that's like a really bad way to choose your leadership. I think that there should be representation. We should have some promise of representation from the different technical areas, and I think that having the liaisons from ISTAR isn't enough. I have not served on a non-com, so this is an opinion without being really grounded in experience. But I think it might be a good thing, specifically if we're concerned about people understanding the needs of the transport area in the non-com process, is to try to find a way to be sure we get some people in the room who understand that.
Jenna Inger, Gauri said something that's been running in my mind, and I think that's not quite captured in the description. I think Gauri, I'll paraphrase Gauri, and I won't necessarily just put words in his mouth. I'll just say it in my own words. That there's leadership, the AD position, what you want is leadership, and you want imagination. It's not about the work that happens in the working groups. There are experts for it in the working groups who can do the work. So the points about condition control and various other things are good to know about, but also, like you pointed out, you can lean on the directorate or folks in the working group for expertise. And I think what I'd really love to see is an AD description that actually talks to the leadership bits, not to the work that happens in the AD, in the area bits. There was just one more point I wanted to gently make, which is about including academics in this process. I think it's a very good idea to include academics in the process, but to the extent that we include them on a without incentivizing this position for them, it just doesn't make sense. It won't work. If you want academics to come in at all, they have to be funded. They have to be agencies that fund them, fund their positions. They can't afford to not teach. They can't afford to give up on their research. That sucks up most of the time, and if this doesn't offer alternatives to those, that part is just not going to work.
Hi, Brian Dremel. I'm going to say something that's potentially terrifying. I'm from BIAB, and I'm here to help. So on the incentivizing academics, I will note as a pseudo-academic, that one of the reasons that I can do this work is that I basically convinced my department a while ago that RFCs count as pubs. That's not a very common thing that has happened in academia. The IAB, the RFC editor are getting DOIs on RFCs, which will make certain organizations that are very bibliometrically focused, shall we say, without any inflection in my voice, that will make that argument easier to win. We hope. That's why we're doing it. Do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, there's another big piece here, right, which is not just the publication, but also the funding bit. If you have institutions like the NSF, like agencies in Europe, government agencies, which traditionally fund research, also fund these positions, that will go a very long way.
That's, I can't help with that part, though. We can put DOIs on RFCs. So I'm hearing the word architecture come up a lot, and actually I'm going to wait for Spencer and Martin to... No, because I'm going to ask. Maybe we can. Yeah, let's... Yeah, we'll talk. Is there anything that, like, in terms of sort of the interaction between TSV and the areas that could come through a program? I noticed that there is, so there's, I'm the lead of the Stack Evolution program, and the Stack Evolution program is packed with, among other things, transport geeks, because that's where the evolution is going to happen at this point, right? There's things that we can do further up the stack, there's things that we can do further, I'm not going to say that. That's where the evolution is, right? And to the extent that there is an ability to have a tighter interplay between the ADs and that program, that might, I don't know what that looks like yet, because I don't actually know what the Stack Evolution program is going to do, because we kind of did the first thing that we wanted to do, which was have a workshop, have a BOF, figure out what the, you know, refer some work out and figure out how that work is going to go. We have to spend a little bit of time figuring out what just happened this week with respect to SPUD and how to take that work, but this could be another thing that could happen within the program, and I'm very open to talking about it.
So just to up-level a tiny bit from that, I went on to the IEB in 2010. The IEB program structure did not exist at that time. So everything that is known about IEB programs has happened in the last 5 years. Everything that has happened with the Stack Evolution program has happened since roughly last summer.
Yes.
And you know, there's a magic moment that happens, I think, in everybody's life from time to time, when you know you realize that the responsible adults that you've been relying on in some situation, that's actually you, and that it, you know, I don't know if we say this often enough, but I think I'll say one more time to increase the chances of us saying it often enough, that we really are depending on the communities spending time thinking about this stuff and thinking about ways that it could work and that it could work better. That's maybe different from the way it's been for the last 10 years at the IETF. You know, when I'm talking with the rest of the ISG, I point out, you know, if you go back and look at the early IETF structure, it changed like every year or two. You know, there were areas that popped up, and there were areas that were renamed, and there were areas that went away, and things were pretty stable for a long time. We created Rye as an area like 8 years ago or something like that. Before that, you know, it was a long, you know, it was a long way before that, before, you know, till you get back to the next time that you created an area going back. But we've probably made as many structural changes in what we're doing in the past year as we had during the previous decade. So the way you think that things work, you were probably right before. Things probably don't, there are a lot of things that are probably not working that way. When I joined the ISG, and the first time Martin and I had breakfast at an IETF meeting, we started talking about, well, what if there was a third transport area director? I was the editor for the RFC that allowed that process change, you know, updating the BCPs to allow that change to happen. It, again, I have an appreciation for irony. If we do the third transport area director, we will be the third area to have three area directors Not the first one, not the second one. You know, routing's already got three, and we're talking about having the art area with three, so we would be the third one to do that. And I cannot emphasize enough that we have no idea how three area directors work in practice, that opens up ways of, you know, ways of structuring the work within the area directorship of an area that we've never had those possibilities before. Just because, you know, if you, you know, allowing somebody to focus, like we've never really had the opportunity to focus when something pops up. So, you know, we're making it up as we go along. We appreciate your thoughts and inputs, and please keep those thoughts and inputs coming in.
At the risk of sounding reckless, I am extremely supportive of breaking things and rebuilding them. And I will note that engineered systems tend to, the structure of an engineered system tends to reflect the structure of the organization that engineered it. And we absolutely need to de-ossify the process stack if we're going to de-ossify the transport stack. So thank you very much.
If anyone wants to design a t-shirt around that, We actually have some relatively recent running code for delivering T-shirts to an ITF meeting and having everybody wear them.
So, Michael Scharf, I'm a little bit scared by what I'm hearing here, and that I might be biased because, first of all, I chair a working group. I often have to say no to academics. And I got told so when I became named chair that that's my job, and I'm doing it from time to time, and people know this. And I work in industry. And a lot of what I hear here is not industrial standardization anymore. And we know that transport has always been a little bit different, but I hear here a lot of research, and that's not industrial standardization anymore. And we have to be very careful about this. And if you go for academics, it can work. I fully believe it can work. But the IETF is an industrial standardization organization also in the transport area. And we have to be very careful about this, in my opinion. And we have the IRTF for doing things, and there are other things, and there are outside the IETF lots of opportunities to doing things. But I think we must not lose. The IETF is an industrial standardization organization and not about research. And that's, I think that's crucial.
Point well taken. I think the fine line to draw is that getting people from the academic world in it and their ideas, and that's, I think, typical. That must be clear. If you become an AD, it's like you might have still your ideas, but primarily you're an AD.
Yeah, but the AD will have to say no to academic ideas, and he will have to say no to vendors coming up.
That's right.
And we have to do this a lot of times, and I'm a little bit. There are people that can do this, for sure, but it's not a typical role of an academic.
So I want to just mention a short commercial for RFC 7418, which I was editor for, that describes research groups to IETF participants, and it has the quote from David Clark in it. If it has to work when you're finished, it wasn't research, it was engineering. And that recognizing that we're the Internet Engineering Task Force, so we are the Internet It Has to Work Task Force.
Hi, Colin Perkins. A couple of things in response to the previous comment, and then I guess the point I got up here to say. Perhaps I'm just not a very good academic, but people seem good at saying no. People in academia seem good at saying no to my ideas. This doesn't seem to be a problem academics have. A second point, I think one of the strengths of IETF is that it has historically been home to both people from industry and academia. It has swung very much in the direction of being an industry standards forum over the last decade or so. I think it has lost something as a result of that, and like encouraging people with different perspectives would be a good thing. Obviously, the people in the management roles would need to be chosen carefully. You don't want someone who's entirely focused on research. Equally, you don't want someone who is entirely focused on instant practical needs and point solutions. But you need someone with a broader perspective. Coming back to the earlier discussion of incentivization of academics, I think there was a lot of good points made, and certainly I'm not going to be one to discourage people from funding academics to do this sort of work. A word which I didn't hear mentioned was impact. As an academic, one can publish research results, and one can try and convince your funders that RFCs are research publications and so on. At least in the UK, and I suspect not only in the UK, there is an emphasis from funding agencies and so on impact of research, and being able to document that impact. Producing RFCs is a good way of doing that. And it's easy to make a claim that if you have published a standard which people have a standard to track RFC as people have implemented, then you are having an impact on the world as a result of your research. It's harder to justify being a working group chair because that seems like management overhead, but I think I could still see if the protocol got widely deployed, I can make a claim for impact. A pure management role, the ISG has an important role. I am sure has an important impact on the internet, but it's hard to sort of point to something which describes what that impact is. If there's a way of making this more visible, I think that may help people in some communities.
So go ahead and close the line now. We've got about 5 minutes, and I would like, at the end of the, before the end of that 5 minutes, I'd like to spend a couple minutes talking about next steps.
Mia Kulevin, just to add on Colin, so I think that the action item you could take is actually go to academic funding, research funding organizations and explain to them how the IETF works and try to convince them that this is actually something they want to see in their project proposal. I mean, it's like in an EU project proposal, it's really good to mention that you're active in standardization, but I think it's different in the US. So that could be something you could actually just go there and talk to the people. Would probably help. The other point I wanted to respond to Michael, and even so, we are industry standardization over here. The transport area is a little bit different because there's often no direct impact into a product. But still, what we're doing is important for the health of the internet, like this trip. and we all know that, but it's not that easy just to say if there's no industry pressure behind it, then we don't do it. So it's a very thin border in the transport area. Yeah, that's all I
want to say. Aaron Falk, so it's the end of the day on Friday, and we've now opened up like a bottomless rat hole. And
Mission accomplished.
And my ability to restrain myself is just gone out the window. But I can't disagree more about the IETF being an industry standards organization. It's an engineering organization. Companies aren't the only ones who do engineering. Governments do engineering. Universities do engineering. Individuals do engineering. Look at open source, for example. So I think maybe you were making a point, but I think that you overstated it. And if you think that academics can't say no, I'd like to introduce you to my friend Joe Touch.
We need to close the mics so that we can do next steps.
Just one comment. Industry might be wrong, but impact implies making money, making products, making software, and these kind of things. It's impact. It's not industrial.
Okay.
Keeping the internet alive.
even the people in here are running. Here's what I'm thinking needs to happen. My esteemed colleague can elbow me at any point. We're going to come up with a description of what we're going to tell NOMCOM. We're going to be telling NOMCOM that we need them to evaluate a slate, and that a slate that probably results in three area directors for transport. We need to continue this conversation about kind of the ways we organize things, because I don't, like I say, I don't see that conversation coming to a quick close, that we figured out everything that we need to do in this brave new world that is transport in the IETF in 2015. You're thinking transport area mailing list for that conversation now? Okay, so I'm getting a yes from my co-area director. We have a lot of work to do, and I think it's work that matters. I think it's work that is starting to affect an awful lot of things within the IETF and within the internet, and I think that's a good thing. I became transport area director a little less than 2 years ago, and I just wanted to say that it has been nothing like I was expecting it to be when I was named to the ISG, and it has been a real privilege to be your area director for my first term and for as much of my second term as it happens until I get recalled. Thank you all for being here, and we will see you in Prague.
If these drugs ever wear off.
Yes.
Cool. That was a good conversation. We need to have these conversations. We need to have these conversations.
One thing for the relevant meeting is the ISG and the IAB. We need to leave that tournament pass.
Okay.
We have to be the plane takes off at 5.
Okay.
And I'm asking Jari to get us up
at the front.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I'll try to think of something to say.
Nothing happened here. Please move on.
So we were talking about Spud. I want to mention Alpo.
Yeah, I will. We should mention the area meeting. I can do, and I will mention TCP Inc. as like uneventful. Also, so now I have to run for the restroom. All right.
I don't think you uploaded the slides, even though when you said you had, I...